Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for joining us for tonight's COVID-19 infection control update. First, I would like to start off by acknowledging the traditional custodians and sovereign people of the land across which we work and live. I recognise their continuing connection to land, water, community, and I pay respect to elders past, present, and emerging. I also extend my respects to any Aboriginal colleagues who may be joining us here tonight. My name is Fleur. I'm from Practice Support. And I would also like to introduce to you tonight to two other colleagues, Practice Support Officers. We've got Sarah Arger and we've got Majida Talib. And then, of course, we have our special guest. I'd like to welcome back Margaret Jennings, who is our guru when it comes to infection prevention. Marg helped us get through 2020 and 21 with what we should do, prevention, and how to triage in our practice. So hi, Marg.
Everybody, welcome from Naam. That's Melbourne. And I live in the northeast of Melbourne in Wurundjeri country. So greetings. It's been a perfect summer's day. All right, hope it has been for you guys too. So look at us. 2 years later, where are we? So one thing I just have to say is I almost cannot believe what I'm hearing in terms of, we don't have to do this anymore, we don't have to do that. Look, we had 10,000 kids positive second week back at school in Victoria. I mean, is this telling me something? This thing has not gone. And so you go, but Mark, you know, everybody's immunised. Well, the rates for third immunisation are not great in the 50s, I think, for Victoria and New South Wales. Not great. And we know that two is not enough. So that's, you know, where are we? We're in the middle of a global outbreak with a variant. And let's not go lame about the variant. It's not as tough or it's not as nasty as Delta. Well, excuse me, it's at least as virulent as the Wuhan and Alpha strain, at least, if not more. The only thing that saved us a bit with the death rates, and remember, we're hovering between 10 and 30 a day in both states, and you've really got to have the stomach for that to say, this is the price. You know, we're prepared to pay this price. What I can say in defence of decisions that are made is that at my local hospital, which is the Austin in Melbourne, nobody in ICU is triple vaxxed. So that's telling you that the vaccine is doing the heavy work. But when I kind of think about general practice, I'm looking at, 30% of your patients being in that vulnerable group. In the broader population, it's about 3%. So you're seeing a lot of vulnerable patients. And I, as a healthcare worker, would not want to be involved in transmission to any of those places, any of those people. So I also don't want to be transmitting within staff. So I still wouldn't be using the staff room, sorry. I would have really kind of set my sail about keeping my practice fairly low risk. And having said that, yes, let's do face-to-face, but I'm going to give some tips on how we can do that safely. And really, do you want things to go back to how they were? A waiting room full of coughing people? I don't think so. So I've got some ideas for you, and I reckon your patients will come along with this too, and it just might make everything snappier and smoother, but you know that we've all got a lot of catching up to do. So you reckon you're tired now, but I think there's a bit of excitement too about what general practice has been achieving, and, you know, just kind of alter the settings a bit in terms of waiting and just making life a bit easier and bit safer too for us and our patients. Interestingly, you know, pre-pandemic, we really didn't have an indication or proof of transmission occurring within the practice. Boy, we've got it now because we know about staff to staff, that's documented. And in terms of patients, I can't actually, you know, give you any of those figures, but I think it's obvious. The longer a patient stays in the one place and there's inadequate ventilation, you know, we've set ourselves up for the transfer. So the masks and the vaccine have done the heavy lifting. There's no doubt about that. And yes, you know, if you want to use the term lockdown, absolutely necessary. And again, I'm a little bit shocked when some of the powers that be say no more lockdowns. Well, really, if we get another variant and a nastier one popping up, I would have thought, you know, one that causes immune escape and there'll be lockdown. So perhaps enjoy what you've got at present. But I tell you what, I'm not out there singing and clubbing. As healthcare workers, I would really hope that healthcare workers are not out there shouting in the bar and doing all that kind of thing, because, you know, you will get it some way or another, pass it on. And so the attitude often is, well, I might as well get it, but it's who you take with you. So definitely infection prevention and control. And yep, everybody's sick of it, but I tell you what, we've adjusted pretty amazingly. So, you know, I'm a bit, to listen to the UK today saying even if you've got COVID, you don't have to isolate. I'm thinking, this is madness. Because I would have thought the one thing we've learned in the last 2 years is that if you, you know, have symptoms, please don't come to work with anything. And think about, too, the parallel is gastro. You are not to come to work till 48 hours after symptoms have stopped. There's just this huge gap in the UK, as far as I can see, but there's sort of no restrictions. There's no, you know, you don't have to isolate. I'm going, this is mad. So that's me. But you know that I'm pretty hard line, but I'm super keen that we run our clinics and they're open and we see our patients. You know, a lot of people have definitely kept up. A lot of clinics have definitely kept up. No waiting room. And in fact, some of them have told me into the future, what they're doing is what they're doing now. And that is the patients, when they make the appointment, the patients, it's look, if you have any symptoms, let us know. The doctor will come out to see you, number one. Number two, before your appointment, give us a call to see if we're running late, because we don't want you waiting around outside too much. And I can tell you in my area, 9 out of 10 patients are waiting outside. So the cleaners are probably loving this because the cleaning room, the waiting room and toilets aren't getting dirty. And also, too, I kind of think that's less of a risk then. If I haven't got patients waiting in my waiting room, you know, piled up on top of each other, then that's less risk to my reception staff. And I've always been concerned about the fact that they're, you know, right there, often sharing the same breathing space. So to me, the practice of the future, or even now, might be, look, the odd patient waits in the waiting room simply because it's too uncomfortable. But yep, and or the patient forgot to call me, or there's a bit of an emergency, fine. But yeah, I'd be thinking about what can be my routine now, because I know that when I've got those bodies together, risk is going to go up and I've got lots of vulnerable people. So I haven't got a normal community sitting in my waiting room. So I'm not going to be using my waiting room for that. If you say to me, oh, but Marg, we've got all the chairs 1.5 metres apart, I go, hang on, this is airborne spread, forget 1.5 metres. So, you know, sure, have a couple of chairs there. I know that a lot of admin staff have actually taken over the waiting room and put a temporary table in there and do a lot of their work there so that we haven't got two working on the same bench. And that's smart. And often that little table is at the door so they can chat to the patients, you know, at the door, which is always safer because I'm going to get good air exchange at the front door. So have a think about, do you really want it to go back to whatever normal was? I don't think normal was really good. Normal was toys and magazines. I don't want to see any of those. So think about some of the really good things that we're just going to keep doing. A lot of staff have said, we're going to stay in our scrubs. We really like the scrubs. Fabulous. You know, we're enjoying going outside to see our patients. We think we'll actually keep that up too. It's more comfortable for the elder person who's not so mobile but wants an outing. We can go and see them in the car. Of course, if they need to come in, they come in. But yeah, we can maybe watch them walk around a little bit around the car park. Maybe we get a better idea of their mobility actually watching them rather than them just taking the 4 steps into our consulting room. I'm not really suggesting that you do wound care in the car. It has been done. But you know what I mean? There's a bit more room to move. Certainly my doctor comes out in her scrubs and sees patients in the car park and then decides, you know, whether we'll follow her, go in or not. So these are some of the things to think about. So you managers out there who are listening, I think it's going to be a lot more dynamic. And, we are running healthcare facilities. We're not running a corner shop. No, we're not providing drink fountains and, piles of linen. I'm happy to say that linen is, I'll be happy to see the end of it. And we do not need to put paper towel in its place. We can wipe down the couch. That is what we've been doing. Let's keep doing that. Let's reduce our waste, spend less time doing the stuff we used to do, like, you know, washing toys. I think, people either bring their own, and, of course, if they're not using the waiting room, I don't need toys. So try to kind of break that mould about what life was like 2 years ago and improve it. So the patient, knows to call. You know, that's on your message or when they make the appointment. Give us a call before you come and we'll let you know if we're running or how late we're running. And when you arrive, just give us, buzz. Don't come in, just buzz. That's what they do at my clinic, you buzz. In fact, they've got a side window. You can tap on the window and say, I'm here. So all sorts of things that people can do. But we know that once we get a number of breathing bodies in the same breathing space, the risk goes up. And all the figures that you're seeing today for New South Wales and Victoria are probably 25% of what's actually out there. You can tell that by the positive test rate. Positive test rate is well above 10%, and it should be well below 5%. It means we're missing loads and loads of cases. And I actually am a little bit upset that we're not getting really good data, because if you look at the hospitalisations, it actually looks quite high relative to the cases that we know about or have known about, whereas really we've got about four times the number of cases that we're seeing daily reported. And that, I guess, leads me to the testing that you might do. So, the schools are doing twice weekly testing, but people are putting a lot of faith in those, in the rats. With healthcare workers, I know with the hospital, they do testing X times per week rat, and then they do a PCR. And I think, given the situation with hospital and vulnerable people, I'd really want to be knowing that there was a surveillance program as well in general practice. So very keen to hear that you're all doing your twice weekly RAT. Some people choose to do theirs on a Tuesday and a Friday so that they know if they've picked anything up on the weekend, maybe just a little early, but Tuesday is probably about right. And Friday, am I good for the weekend? So people have kind of got that bit sorted out. And the PCR in the hospitals, they're doing those weekly, but I don't think for general practice there is. So you might say, well, I'm doing the testing and, isn't that enough? Well, the testing didn't actually stop you from getting it. It tells you if you're infectious, by which time you've probably passed that on to somebody else. But at least if it is positive, you don't go to work. And we also know that within about 5 days after you becoming infectious, really the virus is gone. So you can see that there was that 7-day thing, which I think in some countries they've brought down to 5. But really people, their peak viral load is, just before symptoms. If they get symptoms, and remember, at least 30% of people are not getting symptoms. And then really after sort of 2-3 days, that peak has gone. So the patient can still be infectious at 5 days, but less so. With our elderly or those who haven't got a fabulous immune, response or immune system, innate, then they find it harder to clear the virus. So I just wouldn't be surprised if in aged care, people are still excreting, replicable virus 5-6 days out. So I'll be interested to see if there's a bit of tweaking for aged care. We certainly know that's the case with viral gastro, norovirus. The elderly really find it hard to clear the virus because they haven't got a great innate immune response. So you might then say, well, do we have to still wear masks? And the answer is, I'm going to lean in and say, absolutely. And I really kind of almost don't care what anybody else says. And I shouldn't perhaps say that, but there is a ton of virus around, a ton. And we're a little bit blind to it, or we're so used to it. And we're not seeing massive numbers dying. But I kind of think 15 lives lost each day could have been avoided. Okay. And it might be people passing that on to others unknown. Flu.
We've got some questions coming through about, okay, so masks is, they're recommended for healthcare and the government and different states are saying different things. But people are asking how helpful do you think they are going to be with the flu season coming? And we've also got a new jump in chickenpox cases. Does that help, wearing masks help with that?
Yes, chickenpox is airborne spread, so a P2 mask will help with that. However, I would have thought all staff who commence work in healthcare have been checked to see that they have had their chickenpox immunisation or have had chickenpox as kids. So that wouldn't be a huge, you'll also get people with shingles and that's the same virus, the reactivation. But going back to the mask, the mask that you'd be wearing is a P2. And this is for airborne transmission, which is exactly what this thing is. And the only time you wouldn't wear a mask in the practice is if you're in a room on your own all day and hopefully with, you know, the window open or some ventilation. So it's never about one thing, reduction. So, yep, we've got the vaccine. Fantastic. But within the, you know, as healthcare workers, the P2, I wouldn't wear it for any more than 2.5, 3 hours. So I'd be going through 3 masks a day. And I wouldn't be wearing goggles, I'd be wearing a face shield. So this thing is, you know, has got an affinity, receptor cells, conjunctiva. So that's what it would be. Now the receptionists say to me, what, us two? And I go, well, guess who you're standing in the same breathing space as each other? I can't tell you the number of times staff have transmitted this to each other. It's like people are still surprised. I go, well, that's where you got it from. You know, I don't go anywhere except work. Well, that's where you got it from. And then we find out by some testing, whoops, yep, somebody, you know, their RAT test the next day is positive and they've already passed it on to others. So you don't want to be in this PPE too much. And so you go outside for your breaks. You know, if there's a park over the road. And I mean, I always say try and have 2 breaks. Have your 2 breaks a day. They don't have to be at meal time. You can have your meal at 11 o'clock or 2 o'clock, but try and get into that rhythm. And people go, oh, that's impossible. Well, I'll tell you what doesn't work, a wet respirator mask. That won't work. So you've really got to set your sail and say, if I'm going into work and I've got to be in this place, shared breathing space with people for 8 hours, I'm going to go through 3 masks. If I can spend a part of the day at home doing some paperwork, then I'm only in this afternoon and I might only need 1 or 2 masks. Respirators, I should call them. The P2s, I shouldn't call them masks, but I'll end up calling them P2 masks for sure. So not every member of staff ends up with 3 respirator masks every day. It's about how long they work for. It's about the days that they go in. And if they can get a space on their own, fantastic. But shared breathing space, you know, even if you say, oh, we're 1.5 metres apart, I go, yeah, but you're in the same office. So then I would look, I would say, well, it's not just about your face wear and it's not just about your immunisation. It's not just about your twice weekly RAT. Let's have a look at the air, the ventilation. And so I say to you, you know, what's the air exchange rate in here? And you go, what's that? And I go, well, how much fresh air is being flushed through here every hour? So some of you are in shopping centres and you go to the shopping centre manager, they look at you like you've got 2 heads. And you go, I need to know. You know, you're not challenging them, asking. Now, they won't know. And so they'll call, you know, the person who looks after the aircon and they'll say, oh, yeah, this place is set for, you know, 4 air changes per hour with 40% fresh incoming. Well, you want 8. Now, you're not going to sort of resign if you can't get 8, but that's what you want. So if you can't get 8, if that's impossible, you've got 2 choices. And one is to move, which I really think is a bit extreme, unless you've got somebody who's just not providing any ventilation. But 2, you say, well, then we're in a high risk situation. We can't get 8.
Mark, on that, we've got a question come through. How can we get CO2 monitors ourselves to monitor their air exchanges or the air to indicate ventilation?
Yep, you can certainly use, and then there's a particular threshold at which it means, whoops, there's not enough fresh air coming in here.
Have you got any brands or models?
I think they're, what, $100 or something?
Yeah.
I can't recommend brands, but okay. I'll tell you what, I'm sure all the medical suppliers are flogging them, you know, big time. All sorts of interesting people use them. So it's not just medical people, but I believe other professions use them too. It's sort of like health and safety people would be really good there.
But so would it be good in general practice?
Oh, yeah, some do. And some of the ones that I've worked with in your PHN definitely use them. But for me, what I would do is say, I'm not going to put all my eggs in one basket. So it's not going to be all about ventilation. It's not going to be all about PPE. It's going to be about all those things. And I'm going to do each one to the level that's humanly possible. So you might have staff who simply cannot wear a P2. And the best they can do is a really nicely fitted surgical mask. Now, of course, that presents a higher risk, but that's better than a poorly fitted P2 that they're always, you know, tugging at. So if I think about the CO2, I would say, well, what else are you doing? Are you, how are you getting your fresh air in? And the person might say to me, Marg, I'm getting 8 changes per hour with 40% at least fresh air. And I'd go, well, I probably wouldn't bother with a CO2 meter.
There's another question. Can we recycle P2 masks by letting them dry out for a couple of days? They're very expensive and hard to get.
Not in the healthcare setting, but at home I do.
Okay.
Yeah, not in healthcare at this point. I always say at this point because I'll give you an example of one thing that was a must and we've gone a little bit lame on, and that is the fit testing. You know, how you get a professional to do fit testing. Well, I actually heard the RACGP saying, even if you haven't been fit tested for a P2, don't let that stop you from wearing it. And I thought, oh, that's interesting. So in other words, you know, in a crisis, in a pandemic, you've got to take some risks. Now, of course, if the world ran out of P2s, yep, we'd all have them on the line for sure. But I would not be recommending it at all for healthcare. But as I said, for some people who just cannot wear them, they might have a higher risk and wear a well-fitted surgical eyes, obviously. But if they can also work in, you know, fairly separate to other people, that's definitely a risk reduction. So look at all the things you do during that shift. And I'm going to bring you right up to your patient in a second, but let's hold that because that obviously is our highest risk. Now, going back to ventilation, you may have a window that can open, but this is what you really want. You want to feel air movement. We've got to get airflow. Sometimes it's just not enough to open a window because you go, gee, it's a pretty still day out there today and your CO2 meter's probably going up. But you might say, well, actually, I can pull the bottom down and the air can, you know, move from bottom through to top and circulate that way. Others have simply paid to have 2 little vents put in walls opposite, or, you know, walls that are external, obviously, but a few metres apart, one with an exhaust fan on it. So air is drawn passively through this one and is exhausted actively through that. That pulls air through. Minimal charge. Some have even had them put in windows that couldn't open. They've actually had them put in there. But you need them a couple of metres apart because the outlet, which is the roof or the wall, you don't want to be taking old air in. You don't want to have them, you know, this far apart. So those vents are like gold. And I'm thinking, we're going to keep those forever. This is good. So that would be, say, in the consulting rooms, or it would be in an office that's shared by 2 people. So that's one more way you can reduce risk. So it's all of those things that I do together, but yet we take a pretty active view. Now, other people have gone straight to, oh, I want to use an air purifier. And I go, let's look at a few other things first. Can you open a window? Yeah, well, open your window. It's going to beat an air purifier every time. An air purifier takes about 45 minutes to completely, you know, go through a room. Some of them are a bit quicker. But if you have an air purifier that you've got to leave your window closed. It doesn't work with an open window because the poor little thing's, you know, beating itself up trying to purify all that air. So if you've got an open window, use it. Others will say, no, we're in a really busy road. We can't stand the noise. And I'll go, okay, window's closed. What are you now going to do? Oh, we've got a split system. Well, a split system keeps me comfortable, but it doesn't give me air. So what are you going to do about air? And they're going like this. And I go, two little vents. That will give you air. And you'll get air moving. You want air moving. Others have said, can we put a fan on? And I go, on the lowest setting possible. But don't have it whipping around because it just moves large droplets towards you, you know, from the patient. So it's that's the sort of effect. So if you have a fan, it's on really low. But most people will use their split system for comfort. And we say, don't have the temperature below 21. That just begins to affect airflow and all kinds of things like that. Others go, well, no, we haven't got a split system. We've actually got a heating, ventilation, air con for the whole building. And that's where you go to the building manager and say, I need to know how many air changes. And it needs to be appropriate. And then others will say, well, we're not even getting four air changes per hour. We're getting three. And that's just not enough. So they may be able to put two vents in or they may not. You see, you really got to work out how well am I doing. Don't sort of say I must tick everything off perfectly. I must have a P2 on every member of staff and I must have eight changes because of air, because all these things are not always possible. And I'm not going to use the waiting room or I'm doing everything right, so I'll stuff the waiting room full of patients. That's not a great idea. So it's all those things. There's about six levers to pull. And I've sort of said this for 2 years. But, yeah, the ventilation is really important. But you can achieve it in many, many ways. But you've got to be comfortable because wearing your PPE, you don't want to sweat and all that kind of thing. So linked in with changing the face gear is also, you know, you'll be cleaning the face shield and popping it into a bag. I've got a new bag for my face shield, all right, a dress bag or something like that, so that when you go out for your break, you've wiped it front and back and hung it up. And the sort of things that we use to wipe would be, you know, our detergent, disinfectant, the two-in-one step wipes, leave it nice and wet so that that can act on any virus that's on there. And then the mask comes off after that. And I think there's stuff on my website that shows you how to put on and take off those masks. So, you know, people will be saying, but they're not wearing masks out there in Sydney anymore. And I'm going, you guys are in healthcare. I bet when you go to a hospital, you'll be required to wear a mask. And I can't see that changing for a long, long, long time. So there's some of the things. And, of course, the other thing is not just testing, but really, are we letting staff back who have got symptoms? Oh, yeah, the pandemic's over. Well, it's not. And no, you're not coming back if you've got symptoms. So you'll see a bit more laissez-faire approach out there in the community. And that can also suit certain other motives that exist in the community. But also, I just don't want the emergence of a more virulent variant. And there will be. There's also a BA2. You're probably aware of that at present. We haven't got good optics on it at present. But I don't think anybody really wants to get this thing. And you don't have to get it. You know, this idea of, oh, well, we're all going to get it. Well, we've probably all been exposed to it by now. But whether we've actually become infected by it, for a lot of us, it might have just given, our antibodies a bit of a boost, or our T cells. Because as you know, with viral infection, you need both antibody production and T cells. Stimulation as well. So I was going to also bring to your attention, you've got to look after your skin, and that includes the nose bridge, because this gets a real hammering when you're, I'll just show you, with the P2, when you put it over the nose, and I'll, and hygiene, always do that before you put your mask on. Now,
show us your hand hygiene that you use. We get that
right. All right. I'm naughty. Strip. I'm naughty. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows I've got a wedding ring on. I'm not going to go to work with that. And I've got my pearls on, and they're just going to get caught in the straps of my mask. So I'm not going to work. I'll keep my pearls on around my neck, because you've got to have some standards in life. So to do your hands, no nail polish, short nails, skin intact. Okay. So always two hands, little blob in there. You can use a gel or a liquid. Dip your fingernails in. Dip your fingernails in. Spread it all over your hands. So it's super wet, really wet. Now start rubbing.
Marge, so, a lot of questions asking about which brand you use, because your one you've said doesn't strip your skin.
Oh, what you do is you get a brand that's for healthcare workers. That's what you do. You don't go down to the supermarket and buy whatever you fancy. So, and can I just say, the healthcare worker brands are cheap. They're actually cheap. Why you use a healthcare worker brand is it is loaded, this is the actual alcohol, is loaded with emollient moisturiser. That's what you want. So it's actually got it in the alcohol. And then you, 2 to 4 times a day, you follow up with a compatible hand cream. So same brand. That's what Hand Hygiene Australia advocates. So it's apply it, spread it, now rub it. And, you know, pads of the fingernails, thumbs, and it should really still be wet at 15 seconds, just getting sticky by about, I'm looking for my little virus. I think some of you have seen, here it is. It needs to be wet for 20 seconds because it takes 20 seconds to disrupt the viral envelope, which is a little lipid coat. So when you do your hand hygiene, that's what you fix on. You go, I know what I'm doing. I am damaging you to stop you coming to my throat from my hands. So that's what you're doing, all right? And then it just goes a bit sticky and soft. And you can, you know, put gloves on or go on to do other duties once it is dry. So it's about 20 to 25 seconds before you can go on and do other stuff. Now, I was going to talk about the nose bridge. So I've done my hands. I'm going to put this particular type of P2 on. So I've pulled the pocket out like that. And there are a couple of different ways of putting it on, but I'll show you this one. So I put my face in. You see what I mean about not having any ear, you know, earrings. Pull it down. About a third of the way down here, and I don't make a V like that. What I do is I mold it. See, it's almost like a C shape. Make sure there's no hair. If you've got really, you know, long hair or frizzy hair, you might want to wear a cap. So make sure it's all straight and out, and then put your hand over it and do some sharp breathing. So I can actually feel it, this bit going in and out. It's collapsing in and out, right? Like that. There should be no hot air coming there. Okay? Put my stop. And which is great if you're wearing glasses. Much easier to wear this. Okay? It is uncomfortable. There's my 2.5-3 hours. So now I'm ready for my break, which might be a coffee break, might be a meal break, whatever. I do my hands, and I'm actually going to lift off this, and I've got my disinfectant wipes, and I'm going to wipe the inside. I'm going to have a reusable one, cross the top, turn it over a bit, and then do the reverse side, then grab a clean another one, and then just, oh, I've actually forgotten. I think we just do the outside with the second one. Really wet, and wet is good because it takes about, you'll get about a 4-log reduction into your bag and hung up on the back of the door. Do my hands. And then to take this off, there are a couple of different ways, but I'll show you one way. Grasp the two away and down into the clinical waste bin. Do your hands. Duck off to the tea room for your cup of coffee. And enjoy it outside. the tea room has become a real problem with people passing it. They go, oh, you see, I don't have to wear my mask when I'm drinking. And I go, yeah, and you're all sitting together with the windows closed and everything. And even if the windows are open, honestly, talking and being around a table is really high risk. So I think you just get into like a normal, how can I make talking around a table normal? Go outside. Some people actually park their cars next to each other and just have their coffee while one's in the car and the other's in their car, and their cars are, you know, a metre apart. And that's definitely low. That's low risk. So I wanted to show the PPE. With the cleaning, the high-touch surface cleaning, this is one thing that I reckon we will keep doing into the future. We used to say just use a detergent wipe to do your high-touch surfaces, you know, your high-touch points, the things that we all share and touch all during the day. And so it's one person's job, really, at lunchtime and, again, you know, 5 o'clock, to what are those? So that you might get 4 different little surfaces wiped with one as you turn it over each time. And I think we're stepping up to a detergent disinfectant rather than just a detergent wipe. Those of you who use a liquid product, straight ViroClean and paper towel, as long as the surfaces for disinfection, as long as the surfaces or decontamination, as long as that little surface, the button, the switch, the keypad, whatever, as long as it looks clean, a 2-in-1 step approach will reduce the amount of virus on there. But if it's full of finger marks, you know, soil, then you're actually going to have to wipe it to wipe the soil off, and then with a fresh wipe, do your disinfection. So you can't disinfect dirty surfaces. They've got to be cleaned first. But if they're visibly soiled, that's it. You know, you need to do that. For those of you using devices like pulse oximeters, stethoscopes, plastic blood pressure cuffs, please just move away from cloth and textile. You can't clean them. And I think the pandemic has also highlighted just stuff we can't clean. And some people have ended up disposing of things where the patient has been, you know, a suspect positive, and they go, oh, what am I going to do? But if you look at, you know, the plastic pressure cups, that's actually a good change into the future. That might actually encourage us when in flu season to wipe over. Getting to flu season, which was one of FLIR's questions, is, yeah, we could be up for a bumper flu season. Now, without sort of moving too quickly away from flu, we haven't got any evidence yet of any new, really, you know, anything new on the flu horizon at this point. And interesting enough, the flu reassortments, the RNA of the flu virus reassorts, tends to actually start in China, which is where people are very close to animals. I mean, there should be no surprise there. And that's not, you know, a value statement. That's just about, you know, you've got a huge population, mobile, and a lot of working with animals, pigs and chickens, etc. So, you know, it's not unusual for those, you know, pandemics to arise in that way. It's been like that, you know, forever. With influenza, we haven't got optics, but you might expect with us wearing our masks, we might not get as much transmission, certainly at work. But of course, when we're at home, we're not wearing masks. You know, we're with the people that, you know, we're sharing the house with. So we'll still get transmission of flu. But there's something else that's happening, and FLIR referred to it just before, that we can see in front of us right now, and that is there's been a bit of an outbreak of chickenpox. Now, is that are those kids who just didn't get around to getting chickenpox because there's been 2 years of we've attended to other health issues and not maybe the childhood immunisation schedule? So that can be one reason. Another might be it's an incidental finding when they do swabs. They are, not that they're checking for chickenpox, but there might be some surveillance going on, which is good, which we're picking up. Or kids have just got symptoms and we test them and bingo, it's chickenpox, it's not COVID. So sometimes things come to the fore during this outbreak that show us what else is going on. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if we pick up some incidental TB and stuff like that. Previously and you know, this year with the respiratory clinics, it'd be interesting to see what the figures are. But what I wanted to also refer to are the other 4 coronaviruses that hang around. So they whether they were ever pandemic, I don't know. This is a pandemic strain. I don't know why people think it's going to really become endemic. It's a pandemic strain. So there are other coronaviruses, four biggies, and we just probably haven't been exposed to those in the last 2 years. I mean, I've had three sore throats in 2 years and none of them were COVID. I'm really hoping that one of them or two of them were coronaviruses, because it's possible that they're giving us some immunity that's being boosted. You see what I'm saying? So that we might be in a better position the more colds we get to actually, you know, fight the big one. So there's a bit of theory around there. But of course, we haven't had those circulating largely. As soon as school goes back, as soon as childcare goes back, the runny noses start. And so the little kids, keep an eye on the childcare and the younger school kids, because what you'll be seeing there is the start of the other coronaviruses, especially as it gets into cooler weather. We'll see those emerge. So they could potentially give their little kids a bit of a boost for when they are in fact exposed to COVID. And they're of course not, you know, they're not in the same league as SARS-CoV-2, but they are corona viruses. Now, I was just going to stop there a minute and do skincare. But is there anything else, Fleur, that's popped up?
Yes, there is two things that have popped up. One is, do we still need to wear gowns? And it was, the reception need to wear gowns?
No, nobody's wearing gowns. No. So here's some good news. We found a couple of things. And one we kind of already knew, but we didn't know how COVID was going to play out. The first thing that we did know from the flu pandemic of 2009 was that we just weren't getting good evidence that transmission was occurring back from a gown. You know, we weren't having evidence of stuff flying off somebody's gown into somebody's throat. We weren't getting that evidence. And so I could see really by a year ago that gowns weren't really having a strong role in general practice. Okay. And yet, you know, you go, oh, but Mark, you know, I've got to wear a P2 and a face shield. Surely doesn't a gown and gloves go with that? The answer is no. It's a bit like in surgery, in general practice, you'll wear surgical gloves, but you don't have to necessarily wear a gown according to, you know, what the procedure is. But you wear surgical gloves because it's the touch points that are the risk to the patient. And you wear surgical gloves because they're thicker, the integrity is better than for a, you know, than for examination gloves. So we know that we could safely attend patients, you know, fully symptomatic, sure, I'd put a gown on. But for my, as I see the patients through the clinic, I've really got my P2. This is where all the action is here for the virus. Okay. Whereas for doing surgery, it's the actions around the hands.
So yep. That question has just been expanded on. Does that mean no gown even for a patient with respiratory symptoms?
Okay, I'm talking about my normal, I'm going to see my patients face-to-face, what do I wear? So my patient doesn't have symptoms, right? So it's my normal, I'm seeing my patients now, you know, X number per hour. So, and that's what the normal clobber. At the desk or even on the phone, the patient is screened. If they have respiratory symptoms, I'm going to go out to their car. Of course, I'm going to miss the odd one. But that would be what I would say is what I'm going to do. And I go, oh, I've just received a call to say that patient who I need to see has got symptoms. I'm going to go out and check them.
So this is about the triage questions still.
Yeah.
Still remember to do the triage questions. And so.
Yeah. But this is the doctor. This is the doctor going out to the patient and saying, I've got this on. I'm actually going to go out and see the patient and work out whether, if I'm going to bring them in, I'm going to put my gown on and gloves. But, you know, that is like the protocol. But what I can tell you is that we haven't got strong evidence. But, you know, the patient might sneeze all over me. For some reason, they pull their mask down. I don't know. But they sneeze over me. The reason you have your gown on is for splash. It's to protect your clothes. That's all. So, you know, if I'm told the patient's symptomatic, I'm going to go out to the car, stand my distance, and then say, yeah, this patient's got to come in, and I'm going to pop my gown on. That's what you do, gown and gloves.
That's just another one. If there's no need for a gown, is there a need for disposable gloves? But I think you just covered that by we don't wear gloves unless you're doing wound care.
Yeah, exactly. Gloves, look, gloves are, I won't say overrated. The place for, please have lots of confidence in your hand hygiene. People often think that I'll use gloves instead of doing my hands. Believe you me, you only put your gloves on when you're going to be doing a procedure, like taking a swab, that kind of thing. Mm. But when I've got somebody in front of, or who I'm going to have in my room who's, you know, symptomatic, I'm going to have the full box and dice on because that's the requirement.
Mm.
But I'm actually going to first of all go out and see them outside because I actually might be able to do quite a bit without actually touching them. I don't know yet. But that's going to give me some optics on whether, A, if they come inside, I'm going to put all my clobber on. So when I speak about the gloves, if I'm doing my normal, regular, this is my day, I'm going to be seeing X patients this morning, and I'm doing my hand hygiene before and after contact with each one. And, of course, I'd put gloves on if I'm doing a pap smear, something like that. But it's when I've got an alert to symptoms that I'll put those extra things on and I just wear those for that particular patient. So this is called transmission-based precautions.
So reception, no
gowns or gloves.
You're just spreading it by touching everything.
Wear gowns
at all because that's just holding it and spreading it and we shouldn't be in that situation in the
first No. For reception and for nurses and doctors, no gowns or gloves unless we've got a symptomatic patient who's best to see outside or I'm doing a procedure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got the patient in front of me and they're symptomatic. I need to have all my clobber on.
And we've still got respiratory clinics going and funded. Yeah. So, you know, if in doubt, you can recommend and patients with symptoms, COVID symptoms that you're not comfortable seeing, go to a respiratory clinic. Yeah.
And I'll actually give you an example too. With the swabbing stations, you'll notice that the swabbers change gloves between patients and not gowns. It's only if somebody would spray all over you. So you've really got to, I'm not saying that we're in that situation because we're not wearing gowns unless I've got a symptomatic person that I'm seeing. And if I see them outside, I probably don't need a gown unless they're going to be sneezing all over me. But the point of the gown is to protect your clothes because we're not getting strong evidence of transmission. And we've known that now for about 12 years. So my receptionists will be walking around in my ideal world. If they're sharing breathing space, which hopefully is really well ventilated, but they've got their P2s on, they've got their face shields, hopefully, and in Victoria that's mandated, and that's it. And they're doing loads of hand hygiene. So looking after your skin. There are two parts that you need to look after. One part you can look after during the day or can do during the day, and the other part you can really only do when you're not at work. So let me talk about the bit that I do at home, and that is my nose bridge. You saw the pressure. That's a metal strap. You know, it's a metal band. So when you get home or before you go to bed, just get whatever you've got at home hand cream-wise, hopefully you've got some, and put it over the nose bridge. Okay, this is an emollient moisturiser, but I don't mind whatever you've got at home. And then in the morning, you know, depending on when you have your shower, whatever, put it on again. Now, we only put this on when we're not at work, for some reason not coming out, because if I start doing this at work, it'll be hard to get a good seal along here. So I do not do my nose bridge. Look after the skin there at work. But what I do at work is my hand cream. So I've done my hands, you know, I'm going to wash my hands if I'm going to the toilet, food, that's washing is all about that. All my hands are dirty. Hand rub, which you saw me, is pretty much all about my clinical work and at reception, etc., and all the other normal things. But food and toilet, No, because the alcohol is not that effective against norovirus, gastro. So that's why we wash hands around food and toilet. So here's my hand. I've done my hands and put on a decent amount and do this 2 to 4 times a day. Now, the best time to put your hand cream on is when you actually start your shift. So when you come into work, start your day with a hand wash, finish with a hand wash. That just gets rid of the soil, etc. But you saw the amount I put on. Rub it in and you'll note that you can't really work for a couple of minutes, then go soft. But what you don't do is just say, I haven't got time to put, I'll just use that. Well, that's not going to do anything. So pick a time, and it might be you're looking over some notes. And what this does is at the start of the day, it actually loads your skin up with that emollient moisturiser, which will reduce the loss of oil and moisture. Critical to keep your hands in good condition. And I think you've all seen pictures of nurses and doctors with damage to that part of the skin. So 2 to 4 times a day, I would say use it with my each break when I'm, you know, zipping off either, you know, to the car or the park or whatever, and when I leave. So 2 to 4 times a day, but you saw how much I used. And see how much easier it is when you don't have any jewellery on. Jewellery can really compromise hand hygiene. So I wanted to get that in. And I want you to think vaccination. People are asking about a fourth vaccination. And yes, for those who are compromised, there are particular situations where a fourth might be, and this may not be the end of it, we don't know. And people who say they do know are on a different planet to people like me. So when they say we're going to loosen restrictions around you don't have to isolate if you've got the infection, I go, that doesn't sound right. And that will lead, it will lead to increased transmission, just as going back to school will lead to increased transmission. So you've got to balance that. You can't say it won't, it will, but you've got to balance that against other things. Well, for me, one of the big balancing is not just mental health and kids being at school. I've got to think about the emergence of a variant, a more virulent variant. So what do we do? Do we sort of keep everybody at home and at school and wait for the variant and close it down? No, it's a little bit unreasonable. So you can see that it is absolutely reasonable, important that kids go to school and that people can, you know, socialise again. That's important. But I think knowing that a mask, you know, I'm carrying it in my bag, that even if I don't have to wear it for things today, that it's so close that for me to be able to jump, because there's good surveillance going on and we'll know when when something emerges that's a bit different, and it will be nothing for people to jump back into their masks or reduce some of their contacts. And I think that will be the rocky road over the next year or two.
I just wanted to see if there's any more questions before Marg wraps up for this evening. If you can just post them on the Q&A. There was one more here, Marg. Your tips for, we've got flu vaccination clinics that will be coming up. Mm-hmm. Any tips on running that? How differently do we do a flu vax clinic to a COVID vax clinic?
Well, you're running a flu vaccine clinic in the middle of an outbreak. Last year, we weren't. We hardly had any numbers last March, April. So, you know, we felt we're in a low-risk zone. Now, thinking of a clinic that I was helping last week, they are running their COVID vaccination in the treatment room, which has got a door to outside. The patient sits literally on the door next, just inside the door. And they've got four chairs lined up just outside. Now, I would just continue that for influenza. I would just continue that. Speaking of the influenza vaccine, the RNA technology, messenger RNA technology is there. And I think there'll be a change with the flu vaccines where they will just no longer be produced on hen's eggs. So they're produced on hen's eggs at this point. There was a foray into cell culture, but that platform, their messenger RNA, platform, that technology's there. And I'm pretty sure that we'll take advantage. So there's going to be a bit of a revolution in terms of vaccination. I know what one question was yesterday. are they going to change the vaccine so it is effective against Omicron? So you know that we get this thing called immune escape, where the virus is able to evade the, by altering, it's able to evade the immunisation. So somebody said, how long will it take for them to alter the vaccine? Well, the answer is about 1 hour. So to actually do that work, you know, that modelling to sort of alter the vaccine takes about 1 hour to sort of do, you know, on a computer, and probably about 6 weeks to the commencement of manufacturing, and probably 6 months to, you know, where everybody can get it. But that's how quick it is. So it's pretty amazing. And I think, as I said, it will revolutionise the way we do immunisation, full stop. But if you said to me, how do you think I should run my clinic, I would also take it literally month by month. If I'm a manager sitting here listening to this, I'd be like, oh, is it going to be like this all year? And I would go, you know what, let's just get February done. Let's just see how figures emerge. And as I said, I'm very disappointed that we're not collecting, that, you know, the data is just not as good as it should be, because people are not reporting their tests. They're going, why bother? Why bother? We don't have to check in anymore. You see, that sort of stuff's going on. Whereas I would really like to know how many cases, because I want to know how many of those are ending up in hospital. It's a bit hard to say the percentage ending up in hospital when you actually don't know your number of cases. This is not telling me about the virulence, really, of the organism. Now, of course, I'm not a player in this, but as long as the surveillance is being done to see if a variant is emerging and whether it's nastier or not. So, as you know, international travel opened up this week and there are less provisions. And so there'll be, again, another mix into it. But we have fairly high numbers in on the eastern seaboard at present. And as I said, you can just multiply by 4 or 5. And that would be the full, you know, that would be the number. So yes, they probably, you know, if we end up with another shot later this year, or even for winter, I don't know, it will be pivoted towards Omicron.
Just a couple, two more questions have come through. And this is to do with the restrictions easing. Would you ask patients to wear masks as well?
Absolutely. They're not coming into my clinic without a mask on. Yeah. I mean, this is like, are people brain dead? You know, this is what I'm wondering. What's going on? So maybe I'm in some other atmosphere. I don't know. But this is the easy stuff to do. The patient doesn't wait in the waiting room, except, you know, if they're the next one, you know, come in, you're the next one, the doctor will call in. I don't mind that. But yes, you've got a mask on, and you know what? Here's a fresh mask, because I can see you've had that one on for 6 months. And would you do your hands too at the same time? Because they're going to be sitting right opposite me in reception. You know, like, kind of all need to. Yeah. So you might have to say to the patients, you know what? There's still a pandemic going on, and you know what? We're healthcare. Yeah. And you know what? We've got the next person coming in will be a transplant. So, you know, we need to remember we work in healthcare, and our job is not to make people sicker going out or to transmit to each other. So I'm really big on that. So, yep, they've all got their masks on. If they forget to bring one, here's one. You're not coming in without a mask. This is healthcare. It's not the corner cafe.
And the other thing I'll like to put in there is that your practice is your practice. It's a private practice. You can have your own policies and procedures about how patients come in, how they leave, how the staff are. But you've also got to provide a safe work environment. And is it a safe work environment if sick people are coming in without wearing your masks? So that's something to think about as well when you look at OH&S.
Yeah. Now, should the practice manager, you know, my ideal practice manager takes this 1 month at a time and keeps an eye on figures. Let's say magically, where are we now? We're the 22nd of February. Let's say magic, a month from now, the 20th of March, zero cases. Well, of course you stop wearing masks. they've done their job. In other words, there's got to be some benefit from the vaccine. That's why we're back at school, you know, back at work. There's got to be a benefit. There's no point immunising everybody three times over and life hasn't changed. So you see there's a sense to that. But you've also got to say that there's a risk if we're going to start mixing. I mean, pubs and clubs and bars without masks and shouting and dancing, that's called a super spreading event. And obviously some people are very happy about that. I'm not, but, you know, I'm not a player there. So thinking about, I have a responsibility as a healthcare worker, but I also need to just see what's happening each day. I mean, is my measure going to be nobody died today? We can all stop wearing, you know, we can stop wearing masks in healthcare. I should want to know how many cases there are. You know, am I the last person standing in Australia who wants to know that? Because that is the surveillance. You know, we need surveillance to tell us what's going on. And if you speak to nurses in hospitals, you know that this thing is far from over. And I actually don't want to burden those people by doing stupid things myself or, you know, spreading it within the clinic. So, yes, of course, look at it. I'm not saying that we'll be having to wear masks all year. It will be going like this year. Okay, and we'll be just so fabulous at all of this if we're not already. So really keep an eye on that. Changes, yeah, is it becoming more virulent, or is there another vaccine coming? Or, you know what, there are hardly any cases. Well, why would you wear masks if there are hardly any cases? And that's the trajectory right now, is down. So it could be really fabulous news in a month.
So, Mark, it's we've come to our time and we've had our questions. I'd really like to thank you for coming and joining everybody here at Central Eastern Sydney Primary Health Network, all our practices in the region. And just to remind everybody that our webinar has been recorded. So thank you, Marg, for letting us do that. And this, it will be on our YouTube channel for a while, so while the information is current. If you've got any more questions that you would like to ask Marg that didn't get done tonight, then please feel free to email them through to the coronavirus@cesphln.com.au. We also have coming up, we've got Marg, who's going to do a special infection prevention session for all of our allied health colleagues. So if you've got allied health professionals, please let them know they can register for that. Also, we are having our triage 2022 webinar that is now live on our events page for you to register. That's triage, especially for front desk, tailored for telehealth emergencies for reception staff. And that's being hosted by another friend of Marg's, Karen Booth, who's also the president of APNA. Marg and Karen worked on the RACGP infection prevention standards together as well. So at the end, everyone, the survey is going to pop up. So if you can please complete your evaluation, and then you'll get your certificate will be sent out with your evaluation once it's complete. And Marg, what else would you like to say as we finish off?
One more thing, because I did leave one little issue hanging. When the patient's face-to-face with the clinician, nurse, doctor, it's really just for the time for that treatment that face-to-face is required. So it's not chatting time. That can be done on the way out or on the phone. It's just for that time that I need to be close to that patient. So my ventilation is sorted. The patient's got a mask on. We don't ask them to take their mask off to check their throat inside. That's like, we don't need to do that. We can do that outside. And the patient, yeah, as I said, is just there. So for a 20-minute consult, only 10 minutes of that might actually be inside. So we know, yeah, inside is a big driver. So the way I run my clinic is I just run this low risk. It's critical that I see my patients. And for some of that, it is a chat, but maybe we can chat outside while you're in the car, away from other people. Privacy is, you know, we've kind of had to just adjust there, absolutely. But, yeah, the consultation may not be all inside. And the less the patient chats away inside, you know, I can keep the risk down. But certainly I need to have the patient in front of me to assess and examine. And all sorts of people have come up with all sorts of ideas. They've decided when they do an assessment on an older person, that's going to be the room where I can open the windows, etc. That was one thing. The last thing was the air purifier. People ask me what type, and I think the only type that's really been sort of examined is a Samsung. It's a portable. I think it's about a metre high and $800. But it makes a bit of a noise, I believe, a little bit of a noise. But really look at other things you can do by just adjusting. All heating, ventilation, air cons can be adjusted. Just need somebody to do it.
Yeah. Is that is that air purifier the one you mentioned where it can go into a room and it can purify the room like in 6 or 8 minutes in between?
Well, you'll get some improvement after a few minutes, but sometimes, depending on the way it's set, it can be also up around 40 minutes. In other words, you just keep running it.
Oh, okay.
But don't sort of go too much into the bells and whistles when what it really takes is for you to just sit and think, how can I get air exchange in here? What's the simplest way I can do this? How can I keep the patient in front of me for the least time?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it's all those things that we do together. And the patient's got a clean mask on. That's an improvement over an old wet mask. So, you know, I'd really be encouraging that kind of thing, but it won't be forever and it won't be the same all year. No way.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you, Mark. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Just a reminder to do your evaluation survey. If you have any more questions for Marg, if you've got accreditation coming up, please send an email through to coronavirus@CESFIN for infection control and accreditation. Send an email through to practice support@cesphn.com.au. Also, some of you might have heard of the word NASH. If you don't know what's happening or you've got some questions, please let us know, because that is a big change happening to everybody's software that needs to be done to work with Services Australia, do your billing and air. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.